Flanders passes for Blenheim, breaking away, leaving the stage clear for the three Hurricanes, type that was, of course, the most numerous in fighter command in 1940. France fell on the 16th of June. Once again, Churchill addressed the House of Commons and the nation.
What General Vaillant had called the Battle of Britain, Europe did it too. The life of the world may move forward in the broad abundance of land. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more progressive.
Blenheim developed the fighter, as is seen represented here by this Blenheim 1F. Our quartet of biplane trainers, meantime, getting airborne off the grass. Blenheim circled fighters in 1940, not least early that year with number 222 Squadron, based here at RAF Duxford. Command was undeterred and continued to strike back, not just with Blenheim, but also Vickers Wellington, Armstrong, Whitworth, Whitley, and Handley Page, Hampton. It was on the 25th and 26th of August 1940 that Bomber Command made its first raid against the German capital, Berlin. Afterwards, Churchill singled out their crews for particular praise.
On no part of the Royal Air Force does the weight of the war fall more heavily than on the daylight bombers, who will play an invaluable part in the case of invasion, and whose unflinching zeal it has been necessary, in the meanwhile, on numerous occasions, to restrain.
Bomber Command's losses during the Battle of Britain were worse than those of Fighter Command in terms of numbers of crew members lost, perhaps understandably, of course, given that these were multi-crew aircraft as opposed to single-seat fighters. In all, 718 men of Bomber Command lost their lives in the Battle of Britain. Thank you. And rather speculated in the case of this performance, back in 17, the Continental Arctic 70, 220 horsepower. By US Army Air Corps General Cap Arnold, and it was one of several training schemes set up by the British to train our own and Commonwealth pilots outside the UK away from the dangers of Luftwaffe air activity. This is the Hockerwoos SW-44 Helix, and this is the Zucca 131 Newman, represented here by a Spanish license example built by the Kanza Company. Human lighter than the Tiger Moth, which we shortly do see once again, and more aerobatically capable. The Luftwaffe training organisation, perhaps, wasn't the best organised as of 1940. It was under the control of the local Luftflotte or Air Fleet commanders. There was no unified training organisation. Some of the ab initio pilots had existing glider experience, courtesy of the Nazi Party controlled. If they were successful, they entered pilot training. The first 5 hours would have been dual, followed by basic flying of various types. And at that stage, the Jungmanns and the Klemms came into their own. Some of the German training moved out to other German-occupied countries. Was the first design of Zucca Flugzeugbau, founded by Karl Zucca at Johanneskarl near Berlin in 1932, but subsequently moved to the airfield at Dransdorf. Large numbers of Jungmann such as this, built under license by the Aero Company in Czechoslovakia, also in Switzerland, and like this one in Spain, in Spanish service. Jungmann carried on for very, very many years until the price was totally outdated. But it was a very, very good aerobatic mount, and there were many famous German aerobatic exponents between the wars who gained a great deal of experience on the Jungmann, including famous female aviators named such as Elie Beinhorn, Eva Bach, and Beat Zucca. It was fully restored in 1990. It's been operated since then by Skytrix. Developed a single-seat advanced aerobatic training variant, the new 133 Jungmeister. 33 designed for 20 years of effect. But the first soft deliveries to the Belgian Air Force were only just underway when World War II broke out. The French Air Force saw 600 of them. But of course, production became impossible when Germany overran Belgium and France. Jean-Saint himself spent the war in France, and to resume his work when hostilities came to an end. Large numbers though post-war among them this one, which was built in 1948. Find them off meanwhile going past at lower level in front of us. We have a CH-82A, perhaps the most famous Royal Air Force trainer of all time. Highest pilot recruits that run the Battle of Britain would have gone first as the initial training wings. They would have done the same square batting on the parade ground. They have undergone ground instruction, maybe including time on the lead trainer, that's rather primitive early form of simulator, and PT, physical training, before they began flying training. To find them off, there's a challenge for students who are expected to go solo in about 6 to 10 hours, at least in terms of ground handling, because we didn't have any brakes. They go to the Gloucester Gladiator into the air, with the curtain 475A1. Tiger Moth really was very versatile, and a number of ideas were put forward to use it in the face of the German invasion of force to lead the Northern Zone aggressors on. 350 of these little aircraft, equipped in August 1940 with light bomb ranks. There was also a proposal, and in fact one aircraft was so trialled, to use the Tiger Moth in what was called a paraflacker. With a large blade because it had to be cut. Apparently, one of these was German parachutes doing their defense twice. That meant nothing, neither did an idea of using Tiger Moth to spray insecticide on advancing German ground forces. As with fighters, production of the Tiger Moth was farmed out to some degree, and the one we see displaying here. Built like over 4,000 of them during World War II by the Morris Motors plant at Cowley in Oxford. What Walker came up with, it has origins of Nimrod in the land-based Fury, but really it's a very different machine. Greater fan wings and for the naval roll flotation boxes, both the wings and the wires. Supermarine Sept 1A, meanwhile, from Comanche fighters rolling off the grass.